Jesus, Lord of all creation, Jesus of God and man. You will I cherish, you will I honor, you are my soul's delight and crown. Fair are the meadows, fair are the woods, robed in the blooms of spring. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, He makes the saddest heart to sing. Fair are the flowers, fair are the children, beautiful.
Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines clearer than all the heavenly hosts on high. Oh, fair is beauty, heavenly and earthly, Jesus in you is found. None can be nearer, fairer or dearer than you, my Savior, to me. To you, my Savior, that way your feet have trod, I will serve and follow faithfully my Master and my God. I vow to you, my Savior, that way your feet have trod, will serve and follow faithfully my Master and my God.
Hello, and welcome to the Gungahlin Anglican Church. If I haven't met you before, my name is Red Taylor, and I'm the senior minister, or the rector, here in the parish. It's great to have you here today, and as we spend some time today thinking about a topic that impacts us all, and the topic is money. Money is something that if you have a lot of it, it can be a problem. If you don't have a lot of it, it can be a problem. And Tim Williams will be taking us through a bit of a reflection on money and its impact on our lives and what the Bible has to say about how we engage with money. I'd like to kick our service off with some great verses that I read through the week, and I want to share them with you. They're from Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 12. Let me read this out for you. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity.
With Tracy. Treasure.
We all love going on treasure hunts, don't we? I know I do. I love hunting for Easter eggs at Easter time. I wonder if you've thought about that word treasure before. I wonder if you've thought about what you treasure. We're going to find out what my friend Merle cherishes and what he thinks is a great treasure.
treasure? Treasure is something valuable, something you cherish. Mill's treasure was a pie. Sometimes certain objects become very valuable and turn into treasure for a while. Valuable jewelry may be treasure to some people. While some see gifts that others have created for them as valuable treasure. Maybe your treasure is a favorite toy or achievements and medals. Maybe you treasure the simple delights of fresh air, blue sky, and nature. What is your treasure? When I was a little girl, my treasure was my hopper, and I used to jump on it everywhere.
Often we think that treasures are objects or things that we own, but today we're going to think about what treasures are.
The Parable of the Hidden Treasure, script by Sandy Galea. There once was a man. This man loved to walk. He loved the fresh country air. One day when he was walking, he fell flat on his face. The man picked himself up and dusted himself off. He looked around to see why he had fallen flat on his face. And there, hidden in the tall grass, was a treasure chest. He picked up the treasure chest. It was very heavy. He opened up the treasure chest, and it was full of the most amazing treasure he'd ever seen. He quickly closed the treasure chest and looked around to see if anyone had been watching. When he was quite certain no one was watching, he hid the treasure back in the tall grass. Just then a real estate agent came along. The real estate agent was putting up a for sale sign. He asked the real estate agent, "How much for this piece of land?" The real estate agent shook his head and said, "Oh, it's very expensive. The owners are asking top dollar." The man stopped to think. He thought about how expensive the land was, and he thought about the treasure, but he just had to have the treasure. So the man said, "I'll be back." And then he ran home, and he put everything he owned up for sale. He sold his drums. He sold his bus. He sold his tractor. Then he sold his car and his house. He sold everything he owned. Then he bundled up all of the money. He had enough to buy the land where the treasure was hidden. So he ran back to the real estate agent. The real estate agent was surprised to see him back so soon. He was even more surprised that he paid cash. The deal was done. They shook hands and passed over the money. The land was his. But more important than the land, the treasure was his. His to enjoy forever.
Jesus says that knowing God is like the man's treasure. It costs everything to know God, but knowing God is worth more than anything else in the world.
Jesus said, "Do not gather for yourselves riches on earth. Instead, you can gather for yourselves riches in heaven." Knowing God is the best treasure we can have because it lasts forever.
Although we are the people of God, Scripture reminds us that we still sin. We need to confess our failures, knowing that the Lord Jesus died for us and intercedes for us with the Father. Let us draw near to God, who freely forgives through his infinite goodness and mercy, and pray to him with sincerity and confidence. And together, Heavenly Father, we praise you for adopting us as your children and making us heirs of eternal life. In your mercy, you have washed us from our sins and made us clean in your sight. Yet we still fail to love you and serve you as we should. Forgive us our sins and renew us by your grace, that we may continue to grow as members of Christ, in whom alone is our salvation. Amen. God is slow to anger and full of compassion. He forgives all who humbly repent and turn to his Son, Jesus Christ, in whom there is no condemnation. Amen.
G'day, I'm Brett from the 10 o'clock service, and I'll be reading from 1 Chronicles, chapter 29, verses 6 to 13, in the New International Version. Then the leaders of families, the officers of the tribes of Israel, the commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds, and the officials in charge of the king's work gave willingly. They gave toward the work on the temple of God 5,000 talents and 10,000 darics of gold, 10,000 talents of silver, 18,000 talents of bronze, and 100,000 talents of iron. And any who had precious stones gave them to the treasury of the temple of the Lord in the custody of Jehiel the Gershonite. The people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, "Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hand are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name."
Hello, everyone. My name's Jenny, and I go to the 9:30 service. Please join with me in reading and listening to the words of Jesus Christ in the Gospel of Matthew, Chapter 6, beginning at verse 19. "Do not store up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourself treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Well, not long ago, I took the life-changing step of getting a new case for my phone. It was life-changing because my new case also has space to carry some cards and some notes in it, so I don't need a wallet anymore to hold my money. It does mean I have to trust my bank more. I have to trust the electronic financial system that my money will be there when I need it. I've had to think about where I put my money just so I can use it. But more important than thinking about where we put our money is thinking about the place in our lives that money already has. How much power we let it have over us. How our relationship with our money determines how we spend it. How we think about buying a new car, or sending our kids to a private school, or even getting a takeaway coffee every day. How much we give away to people in need, and how much we invest in gospel ministry. What place should money have in the life of a disciple of Jesus? What place should money have in the life of a disciple of Jesus? We're in a short sermon series presenting biblical teaching on some hot topics, and this week's topic is money. We'll be focusing on Jesus' teaching in Matthew 6. We'll see Jesus teaching us using three different sayings that we can't grow as his disciples by centering our lives around money. The passage is part of a larger section, sometimes called the Sermon on the Mount. And this section records Jesus' wisdom and instructions to us who seek to live as his disciples. We'll be looking at what he says about money in our hearts in verses 19 to 21, money in our eyes in verses 22 to 23, and then money and our masters in verse 24. So let's look at Jesus' first saying in verses 19 to 21. Do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. When we put our money in the bank, we don't worry too much about it disappearing. But banks were rare in Jesus' time. Most people who were able to accumulate some wealth, they kept it at home in the form of tradable goods like fabric or perfume or gold, much less secure than a modern bank. And Jesus uses this well-understood idea of the insecurity of wealth, earthly treasure, to highlight the superiority of heavenly treasure. He's not saying take all your gold to the temple and it'll be magically sent to heaven for safekeeping. He's also not saying just wait a couple of thousand years for the modern financial system. He's using the idea of treasure to describe the things in life that we desire and pursue. Earthly treasures are material things, money, and the things that money buys. Heavenly treasures are things we pursue that will last beyond this life. Things that might cost us money we have, or opportunities in life to make more money. Acts of kindness and generosity. Pursuit of holy living, growth in spiritual maturity. Jesus is saying that his disciples should treasure these things instead of wealth. And if we do, then our character will be shaped by them. That's what he means by a heart. In the language of the time, a person's heart was the core of their being, their true character. A disciple's true character is heaven seeker, not money seeker. Let's move to Jesus' second saying in verses 22 to 23. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? So Jesus goes from talking about our hearts to talking about our eyes. He's being figurative again, and he uses some wordplay here that doesn't translate easily from the original language. We'll have to talk about how that works another time. But his idea is that we use our eyes to see the world around us, and the way we see the world affects how we act. If we have healthy eyes, as the NIV translates it, we see the world and its needs in generous terms, undistracted by the temptations of money. If we have unhealthy eyes, we see the world with a jealous stinginess. And if what we use to look at the world is bad, we can't help but be led to a bad place, he's saying. So disciples should be careful about how they look at the world and its needs. Jesus' third saying about money is in verse 24. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. When Jesus talks about service and masters here, he's again tapping into ideas that were very familiar to his original audience. A person who served a master, a servant, was owned by that master. From morning to evening, they devoted themselves to doing their master's bidding. Their life revolved around their master. In return, their master provided food and clothes and a place to sleep. And Jesus is saying that money can be master over you in the same way. From morning to evening, you do what you have to do to get money. Your money then provides for you to eat, to wear clothes, and to sleep in a house. Everything you do is in service of getting and using money. It doesn't matter whether you're accumulating a vast portfolio of wealth, or you're up to your eyes in debt repayments, or you just spend everything you have as soon as you get it. Money can rule your life, he's saying. And if money is the master you serve, you can't also serve God. The life of a servant of God and the life of a servant of money have some things in common. They both go to work, they get paid, and they pay the bills. But a servant of God knows that all things in the world, including money, belong to God. Our Old Testament reading is about how the people gave generously to start work on building the temple. In verses 11 and 12, David prays in response to this. Yours, Lord, everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Wealth and honor come from you. A servant of God goes to work and gets paid, but they know that God has enabled them to work. As they pay their bills, they know that it's God who's providing for their needs. They're generous with their money, using it to help others, using it to grow God's kingdom beyond themselves, because they trust that God will continue to provide. They know that God isn't constrained by exchange rates or transaction limits or overdrafts. The national budget was on TV a couple of weeks ago. It was a reminder that so many things we need are ruled by money: infrastructure, health, education, law and order, our national security. But a servant of God is free from the mastery that money has over the world. In that freedom, we also see the freedom of our salvation. The free gift of God's grace means we're free from a transactional system of obedience and reward. We're free from the mastery that sin has over us. Because we serve God, we're free from all other masters. What place does money have in your life? I've got three things for you to think about at home this week. Firstly, if our generosity is getting cold, we might get annoyed when people tell us of needs for money. My money's my own, we think. We're losing sight of who it really belongs to. Perhaps our eyes are becoming unhealthy. How healthy are your eyes when it comes to your money? Secondly, maybe we pretend that money doesn't exist. Maybe we just let it come and go without thinking too much about it, as if it can't possibly rule over us if we just ignore it. But going about in this world that God has created as God's servants still involves using money. Whether we have a budget written down or not, we need to have some way of knowing how much is coming in and where it's going to. Only then can we know if we're using our money the way a disciple of Jesus should. Do you know where all your money goes? And thirdly, does your spending attest that you are a generous disciple of Jesus? Remember that generosity is both a discipline and a joy. From verse 9 of our Old Testament reading, the people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. May we have that same joy over the way our community uses God's gifts of money to us.
Welcome to our service. My name is Graham Lindsay, and I come from the 10 o'clock service at Ford. I'm about to lead us in prayers, and I acknowledge that the idea for these prayers came from a reflection by the Professor Marilyn McIntyre, and that reflection came from the Upper Room Disciplines 2020. When God called Moses and Aaron to free the people from captivity in Egypt, God guided the people by day and night. And even though they grumbled and complained and doubted, our holy God remained faithful to them, leading them to the promised land. Let us now pray to this God of ours, the sovereign of the universe, a God who listens to us and hears our cries. sovereign and holy God. In these days of turmoil in our world, it seems that no one is listening to us. Who will comfort? Who will guide and lead? Who knows the way to go? Who will listen to our sadness, our grief and despair? Only you, our constant and faithful God, to whom we belong. You will hear our prayers. You hear the moaning of a wounded and warming world, of a wounded church and a wounded people. You hear the crying of those who have lost loved ones in disasters, in wars, acts of terrorism, instances of gun violence. You hear the anger and the pain of victims of abuse, sexual assault and discrimination. You hear the prayers of those who suffer because of the colour of their skin or their country of birth or their immigration status, and those who suffer at the hands of authorities that show no compassion. You hear the despairs of our young people, of LGBTQ people, and many who struggle, wondering if it is worth continuing in this world. God of compassion and mercy, you hear the cries of our own hearts, for our own family, our own neighbours and our friends, who are in any kind of trouble, need, sorrow, depression, sickness, isolation, or darkness. Lord, hear the voices of our hearts right now. We lay all these concerns at the feet of Jesus, at the foot of the cross of Christ. We lay down these burdens and hand them over to you. For when we ask in faith, you promise to hear us and answer us according to our need and your will. Grant us wisdom, inner truth and peace, and a light for our path, that we may know how to be your people in a strange land. Grant comfort and well-being to those for whom we have prayed, and show them through us a well-lit pathway to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy and generous God, we give you thanks and praise for all the gifts you've given us in this life. Christ is sufficient for us. Your love is sufficient for us. May we share our love, our time, our talents, and our money with our community and our neighbours, that your name may be known and loved, and all your people are delivered into the promised land. Bless these, our gifts, to the service of your kingdom and in the service of all whom you love. Lord and Heavenly Father, you have brought us safely to this new day. Keep us by your mighty power. Protect us from sin. Guard us from every kind of danger. And in all we think or speak or do this day, direct us in the fulfilling of your purpose through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, it's been great to have you here as part of our service today. It's just a couple of things I want to let you know about. If you haven't picked up on it already, as well as having an online service today, we've also started back with some face-to-face services. So this Sunday and next Sunday, we'll continue to have our online service as well as the face-to-face services. And as of November, we'll continue with our face-to-face services and an online presence, but it'll be kind of a bit simpler, a bit reduced compared to the online YouTube service that we've been running. So I just want to let you know about that. If you have any questions about the services and the service options, if you have any questions about what is involved with going back face to face, then please contact the office. A couple of things that you do need to remember though is if you're coming back face to face in the mornings, at the moment we're meeting outside. There are no chairs provided, so you need to bring a camping chair or a chair of your own, a comfortable chair that you can sit in for the service. You also need to know that if you're coming to the evening service, that's not an outside service, that'll be indoors, but it'll be indoor at the Salvation Army location in Gungahlin. And so bookings are essential for that service in particular, but we're trying to encourage everybody to pre-book, to say that you're coming along. That helps us to prepare in appropriate ways. So that's a little bit of an update. Again, any questions, get back to the office and we can get you some more information. We're going to conclude our service with the words of this final blessing. Well, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.